Welcome to another episode of Salon Life. With What Salon? Everything you need to run, manage, and grow your salon business. This is Salon Life.
Another episode of Salon Life with What Salon. Today I have Simon Hill from Sesh Hairdressing in Edinburgh. Sesh Hairdressing was founded in 2004 and he has a staff member who's been with him from the very beginning, and his newest staff member joined him 6 years ago. So Simon, thank you so much for joining us today.
No, it's an honor. Thank you for having me on.
So Simon, tell me a little bit about your journey and how you got into hairdressing and opening a salon, and what was your inspiration?
Cool. Really, it all kind of happened by accident. I was politely asked to leave school when I was 15. And I kind of dusted about a little bit and didn't do an awful lot. I was not the best of cancer. And my mum took me to go and get my hair cut so I could start applying for jobs in shops. And she was chatting to the hairdresser about how much of a nightmare I'd been. And the following day, I got an interview in that salon. And the day after that, I started. I've been so fortunate, really. I've landed on my feet a couple of times throughout my career. But it's been, unbeknownst to me, there was a salon called Clowns in Edinburgh at the time. It's not there anymore, unfortunately. But it, at the time, was one of the kind of, sort of top salons in the UK, let alone Edinburgh. So it's, I really kind of landed on my feet with that and was very lucky.
And that's where you ended up?
I spent 6 years there and then moved to Medusa, which is another salon in Edinburgh. And they sort of refined my skill a little bit more with them. And then moved around a little bit and then opened the salon in 2004.
So what inspired you to open your own salon?
I think that was always the plan. I think it's when I first got into hairdressing, I saw it as an opportunity to go into business more than anything else. And it's, and you know, I love the craft and love what I do is a bonus, really. But it was always my kind of sort of plan to open the salon. I think possibly in hindsight, I was a little bit young when I first opened it.
How old were you?
I was 22.
Wow.
So it was pre-recession when the banks gave you anything you wanted. So it's, I had a look at my business plan a little while ago, actually, and it's embarrassing. So what I put into that to where I should be, according to my business plan, is quite a different place to reality.
It's always that way, though, isn't it?
Yeah. I think the problem is at 22, I was very confident in my hairdressing ability, but I had absolutely no business skill at all.
Of course.
And that's where I really had to learn how to run the business and how to look after staff. And it's through mostly trial and error, really.
However, it seems that you have done a fantastic job, because you said that you have one employee that's been with you from the very beginning and your newest employee has been with you 6 years. So what is your secret? Because staff retention is a difficult area for salon owners. So what do you do differently?
You know, I think it's mostly about being honest to people. It's, and telling the truth, really. I think it's unfortunate Mark, who's been with us since before we had mirrors, actually. He kind of sat in the back room with me while the builders were still working.
Wow, brilliant.
I think there's been really tough times in the salon. There's been great times in the salon, and we're fortunate we're in a good time this now. But I think when things are difficult, it's about sitting down with your team and explaining to them that it's difficult and why it's difficult. And I think the more you try and hide from your team and take it on your own shoulders, I think the less it is about being a team and more it is about being an individual.
That's a very interesting point. So even just by being open with the problems and the struggles, then they almost have a sense of ownership with it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think I'm fortunate enough that my team, I think, feel as proud of our achievements as I do. It's and the pride that I have in them and so how far they've come through the development we've given them with the education and the training is incredible. I do believe we've got some of the best hairdressers in the country with us.
Brilliant. And you do your own staff training and education, do you? Most of your staff come through your own educational system. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, we do a combination of a couple of different things. So we do our own in-house training, where myself and Vicky, one of our creative directors who came through the salon process herself as well, we take on the training. She does most of the practical and the theory, and I do a little bit of cutting towards the end of her training. Okay. We use the Medusa training structure for all our theory work. Okay. So we kind of sort of feel it's better to bring somebody in for that, because I think a lot of apprentices come straight from school, and I think it's quite useful for them to still have that slight school thought process. So when Medusa training come to the salon, they've got their workbooks and they've got their homework and they've got things to do by certain dates. So we try and keep a little element of what they're used to into it.
Okay, interesting. And the way that you structured your business with your staff, you sort of mentioned the other day that you focused first on creating a career for your stylists. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
So the thing was, I suppose, what's the best way of wording it? Our priority was getting bums on seats in the salon, for want of a better word.
Of course.
We've got a beautiful salon. It's great having a lovely looking salon. I think what we had to do is make sure that we've got careers that are building for the hairdressers. So each one of the hairdressers has a development plan as to where they want to go and how they're going to get there. And sometimes it's very quick and sometimes it takes time.
And do you work with them to create that plan, or do they sort of make that of their own initiative?
A bit of a combination of both, really. I think we need to sit down quite regularly. So in the salon, we have a meeting every single Thursday morning where we have a quick 15-minute chat with everybody to let them know what happened in the previous week, what's happening the following week.
Very good.
And then we have quarterly meetings with the individuals where we go through the previous quarter, and sometimes in a lot of detail, sometimes in a little bit of detail. And within that, we can review when they might want to go with more education, or where they might want to get involved in more photographic work or stage work. And we're starting to kind of sort of work into that a little bit more now.
That's excellent. So you're sort of like helping them to accomplish their dreams through SESH.
I think so. Yeah. I think if you don't allow people to kind of accomplish their dreams within the salon, they'll look elsewhere.
Yeah.
So I think if we can sort of help them to kind of sort of create where they want to go in their careers, then they'll stay with us.
So would you have any tips for other salon owners that are struggling with staff retention, like anything that they could do to sort of restructure and encourage, first to be able to recruit staff in the first place, and then to be able to keep them and build that loyalty that you've just been talking about?
I think that the best way that we've found building loyalty over the years is to bring them up ourselves. So we've brought in apprentices from sort of 15, 16 years old, and they've worked with us right the way through their careers.
Which is quite fascinating. Account your own story as well.
Yeah. And I think it's nice because I think we've had Lorraine and we've got Vicky and Rebecca, who have all come through the process since they were quite young.
Brilliant.
And I think they've taken ownership of their own part of the salon. The hardest thing is to try and bring somebody into a settled team that can hit the ground running, really. And the part of the problem is now we're now at the point where we're so busy we need to bring somebody in, because it's going to be a little while till our next assistant is on the floor.
Right.
And it's difficult. It's difficult finding the right person.
That's interesting. And so tell me about the ethos of your salon and what differentiates you.
Mostly it's about customer service. We've tried to find a kind of sort of market within the salon where we can really look after people. So I think the recession was a really important time for us because it allowed us to really harness what we're good at. And I think we're a haircut or a colour or whatever the service would be, went from being luxury. And now it's still a luxury, but it's a luxury necessity, if you like.
Right.
So clients still are coming in every kind of sort of 6, 8, 10 weeks or so. But I think they expect a little bit more just the haircut from the leave. So we've put in a structure for little things, that we have the two-step rule. So a client is never allowed to wander around the salon on their own. A member of staff has to be within two steps of them at all the time.
Okay.
And guide them around the salon so they're not just standing looking
very good,
sort of uncomfortable in the middle of the salon. So they'll always be looked after when they're in.
Yeah, very good. That's excellent. Could you tell me a bit about the business model that you used?
Yeah, of course.
The business model that you used in setting up SESH.
So it had to evolve, really. My stepdad helped me quite a lot when we first started off. It's from an engineering background. And the problem with that, to an extent, is he would look at it from, like, well, on the 15th of February last year, we were really busy. So why are we not busy on the 15th of February this year?
Okay.
So he was looking at it very much from a sort of numbers point of view.
Right.
Where it has to be an evolution. So I quite like seeking advice from lots of different aspects and lots of different people in my clientele and my friends. And I think where we started from with the first original business plan, so we had to evolve and let it be organic and let it sort of change. And if something good happens, run with it. If something bad happens, learn from it. It's certainly, if it's mechanical can break. Where if it's organic, it can evolve and change.
Very good. And so are there any learnings that you could share from your journey, like kind of transitioning from the more mechanical numbers approach?
Yeah. I don't think there's anything that I've not seen in 15 years. I've learned from an awful lot of different things. I've had to hold my hands up to say that I made a mistake with that, I made a mistake with this. And it's so I think it's allowing yourself, again, it's going back to being honest. I think it's allowing to kind of hold your hands up and say, whether it's the team or whoever it is, they go, you know, I've messed up there. That's not worked. And figuring out a way of repairing it or fixing it. It's I really do believe that that's the kind of best way of moving forward as a team and as a collective. So I think if I hide in the office and I don't tell people what's going on,
yeah,
then they've got no idea why a certain day might be stressful or a certain day might be great. It's, so I think it is. I think it's key to be, yeah, to be open and factual with people.
I really like that approach. Just it's almost like a family environment rather than just a work environment.
100%. So, and that's going back to my time at Clowns. That was very much the environment that we were in there. So the salon owner was a guy called Derek Preston. It's, and we all looked up to him in that same manner. And I think we had a phenomenal family unit there. And it was very sad when it eventually demised. But, so I've tried to pick the best bits of my time with Clowns and the best bits of my time with Medusa and bring them into the salon with me here.
No, I love that. And it makes it fun to come into work if you have that environment, doesn't it? It makes it...
Totally, yeah, yeah, we do. Yeah, we have a lot of fun. It's kind of sort of, we try and prank each other at least once a week.
Oh,
so
really?
We film it and then we show it all at the team meetings. So yeah,
what's
whoever
gets
the best prank wins a prize. It's mostly just jumping out and scaring people.
Oh, okay. old school.
Yeah. It's good fun. No, it's good. It's we've got a nice bunch. They're a good team.
Oh, that's very good. So would you have any tip for somebody who might just be thinking to open a salon? Any tips that you could give them?
I think to know your market is the best one. It's, you need to know what's around you, what the clientele base is. You know, it's whether you're appealing to young professionals, or you're appealing to sort of a more mature market, or whether it's a student market. You need to kind of know who's around you and not just to rely on them coming in. It's, we found that we've used every single type of kind of sort of promo over the years, and flyer dropping doesn't work. You know, sort of going to an office and offering them an incentive doesn't work. The key is to really look after people. So it's, and it's the old analogy that if you do a good haircut on somebody and look after somebody, they might tell a couple of people. But
yes,
if you do the wrong one and do something wrong by them, they'll everybody, and particularly now the dangers with social media, you've got to really make sure that you're on top of your game all the time.
It's really the relationship building and word of mouth then?
Totally. Yeah. And I think, and I'd like to think our clients feel that we're as part of their community as they are of ours. And down in the shore of Edinburgh where we are, it's evolved massively from 15 years ago where it wasn't necessarily the kind of sort of gentrified place that it is now. It's
right.
To now the hub of Edinburgh. It's a fantastic area of Edinburgh.
Fantastic. So you're sort of extending that family environment to your staff and then also to your clients.
Yeah. So 15 years ago when we opened the salon on the shore, it wasn't what it is now. So now it's this kind of sort of very cool, very kind of, sort of nice little area. But when we first opened down here, it was a little bit rough around the edges. There was little pockets that were really nice, but it was but it wasn't what it is now.
Okay.
So we feel we've grown with the area. So when we were looking to open a second salon, we were kind of sort of, we were traveling all over Edinburgh looking at units. And then a friend of mine said to me, you should just open another 5 seats. So we ripped out the whole salon, refitted everything.
Wow.
So we went from, originally when we opened, we were a 6-seater salon, and then we went 8, 10, and 15. So we're fortunate enough that we've got an enormous space to
wow.
kind of play around with. So now we have the 15 units within the salon.
Ask that. Brilliant. And so you were talking about marketing and how treating your customers right is the best way to bring people back. Do you have any tips for getting people in the door in the first place?
Again, well, we're not using ADC.
They're fantastic.
As our marketing consultancy, it's been fantastic for us, incredible. And they're pushing the company, not in the company, it's been great. Before, we were just doing what we're doing. We were quite comfortable with what we're doing, but we didn't really talk about what we did.
Right.
And it's only really been since we brought in ADC that we realise, you know, we've actually got something to shout about down here.
Very good. Excellent. So I love working with Alison and AJC93, yep. But could you give me some insights as to what they're doing for you as well?
At the moment, we're working on a couple of things, on reputation within the industry. It's, and I'm currently working on my own profile within the industry as well.
Brilliant.
So for the last 15 years, I've been concentrating on the business. So I've almost done it back to front. It's a lot of sort of hairdressers within the industry. And it's they often kind of do the stage work and seminar work and then go and open the salon. But now that I've kind of sort of, you know, I've had a family that's still young, but I've got a little bit more time for my career now. So I'm pushing that a little bit harder now.
Excellent.
It's pretty sort of, they're pushing. Sorry.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
No, carry on, sorry.
I was just going to say, I love how you formatted your business in building the careers for your stylists first, and then now you're bringing out your own profile. It's a little bit backwards than what you what you tend to see, but I really love your approach. I think it really says a lot about you.
Yeah, I think the important thing is, you know, it's lovely to see stuff. I really, really enjoy it, but my fundamental was to sort of build a business that can support me and my family, can support my staff. It's, I think if I did it the other way around, I think sometimes you can spread yourself a bit too thin.
Yes. No, I think that's a very good point. Simon, I'm going to say goodbye now, but thank you so much for all of the insights that you gave and for sharing your journey with us. It's really quite fascinating. And we'd love to chat with you again.
Super. Thank you. Thanks very much, Naomi. Cheers.
Thank you. And thank you for joining Salon Life. And join us again next time for another episode of Salon Life with What Salon.
This was another episode of Salon Life with What Salon. Visit our site at whatsalon.com for more episodes.